$2 trillion and 20 years. That's the money and time spent by the USA on the Afghan war. As one of the world's strongest military leaves the country, the Taliban is gaining power and winning over a major portion of Afghanistan. And this is a crisis we must all look into. The announcement that the US will bring back its troops by the end of September 2021 and the growth of Taliban in that region has created a new crisis of power in Afghanistan, which will also have a major impact on Asia. Countries like Russia, China, Iran, USA, Pakistan, and India have their direct interest in Afghanistan, which is now becoming a matter of concern for these nations. Part of Afghanistan's appeal lies in its geographical location at the central heart of Asia, thereby giving it control of a key commercial hub linking the Middle East, Asia, and Europe. Afghanistan's vast untapped mineral wealth is another factor. Afghanistan has been known as the graveyard of empires due to its mountainous terrains, which makes it harder to connect different areas and supply resources. It also has many tribal groups who are experienced in guerrilla warfare after being invaded over the centuries. However, a few empires have conquered Afghanistan, such as the Greeks under Alexander, the Mauryans, the Sassanids, and the Mughals. With Taliban now claiming its presence on more than 85% of the country, its claim to power seems inevitable, and in this video, we shall discuss the origin of the Taliban, its impact on Asia, and most importantly, India. But before we move further into the video, please make sure that you scroll down and subscribe to our channel with the notification bell on for more such videos. To understand this complex geopolitical crisis, we must first take a deep dive into the history and understand how the Taliban came into existence. The borders of Afghanistan in the 19th century used to be very different from what we see today. It used to border the Russian Empire in the north and the British India in the south. Sandwiched between the two powerful countries, Afghanistan acted as a buffer zone between them. Both the countries were wary of each other's interests in the region. The British were under constant threat of a perceived Russian invasion, due to which they were eager to protect all approaches to India. This was known as the Great Game, which was a political and diplomatic confrontation that existed for most of the 19th century and beginning of the 20th century between the British Empire and the Russian Empire. In the First Anglo-Afghan War in the 1840s, the East India Company seized control of Afghanistan, but only for a short period of time, as they were defeated and had to go back by 1843. In the Second War in 1878, the British emerged victorious and managed to capture some parts of Afghanistan, but they never intended to settle. They let internal rule remain in Afghanistan, as they merely wanted to have influence on the buffer zone with the Russian Empire. In 1893, the international border between Afghanistan and British India was drawn, known as the Durand Line, which is still disputed by Afghanistan and Pakistan. An agreement between the British and Russian empires in 1907 concluded with Russia recognizing British control over Afghanistan and promised to never intervene. However, the Third Anglo-Afghan War soon followed in 1919, after which the country became independent of foreign influence, eventually becoming a monarchy under Amanullah Khan. Amanullah Khan had a very progressive mindset, and he broke the long tradition of polygamy in his dynasty by marrying Soraya Tarzi. Soraya, using her position as queen, paved the way for positive social change in Afghanistan. She revolutionized the way women were treated back then by starting schools for girls, working for equal rights for women, campaigning against polygamy, reforms in the dress code, and the right to divorce. Secularism was promoted with secular courts and secular education, free from religious conservatism being set up. However, these changes did not sit well with large sections of the Afghan society, which triggered mass rebellion in 1923 and 24. Even though they were easily crushed, another rebellion in 1928 succeeded and marked the start of the civil war of Afghanistan. However, the rebellion did not last very long. Muhammad Nadir Khan, cousin of Amanullah Khan, defeated and executed the leader of the rebellion in 1929 and became king. In 1933, Zahir Shah, his son, became the new king of Afghanistan, and he ruled for the next 40 years, during which he led modernization efforts and worked on building healthy relations with other nations. Afghanistan remained neutral during both World War II and the Cold War. However, it benefited largely from the Cold War as both the Soviet Union and the United States competed for influence by building Afghanistan's main highways, airports, and other vital infrastructure. Therefore, Afghanistan had good relations with both the Cold War enemies. Come 1973, Daud Khan, the king's cousin, abolished monarchy and became the first president of Afghanistan in a bloodless coup. His government introduced many reforms for modernization and hence was considered too radical by some. Conservative, Islamic, and ethnic leaders began an armed revolt in the countryside against the social changes, who later organized themselves into the Mujahideen. Then, in 1978, the Communist People's Democratic Party of Afghanistan seized power in a bloody coup against Mohammad Daud Khan in what is called the Sour Revolution. Nur Mohammad Taraki took over as the president with full support from the Soviet Union. Under the influence of USSR, Taraki continued the modernization of Afghanistan. To counter the Soviet influence in this geopolitically sensitive region and to avoid losing any other country to the Soviets, the USA started to support the ethnic Muslims of Afghanistan, stating that their religion was in danger and they must stop the modernization to save their religion. This led to unrest in Afghanistan, which could be seen as the baby step in the formation of Taliban. Soon after, Taraki was assassinated by his own foreign minister, Hafizullah Amin, who had decided to side with the USA after the CIA informed him of a conspiracy against him. Hafizullah Amin now took over as the president. The USSR knew that only a Soviet ally within the government would serve their interests, and in 1979, they invaded Afghanistan. Arriving at Kabul, the Soviet army staged a coup, killing the ruling president Hafizullah Amin and installed their ally Babrak Karmal as the president. Seeing this, the US planned to tackle the Soviets by its largest ever secret operation, funding the Mujahideen. Along with the CIA, Pakistan's ISI, Britain's MI6, and Saudi Arabia also started to support the Mujahideen cause. A bitter civil war began between the Mujahideen and the Soviet troops, with cities mostly under Soviet control and the rural parts under Mujahideen control. The Mujahideen, being natives, were very well adapted to the terrain and climate and used this to their advantage in the guerrilla war against the invading Soviet Union, with monetary and ammunition backing. The Soviet troops eventually withdrew from Afghanistan in 1989 after 9 long years. The USSR continued to support the next president, Mohammad Najibullah. However, the Mujahideen wanted to establish their own government in Afghanistan and were still being backed by Pakistan and the US. After the fall of Najibullah's government in 1992, the Mujahideen, which consisted of various ethnic groups, started fighting internally, and the rivalry turned into a full-blown civil war, which eventually ended in Burhanuddin Rabbani taking over in 1992. Then, in 1994, a group of students seized control of the city of Kandahar and started a battle for power to control the entire nation. They were called the Taliban, which means student. They were led by Mullah Omar, who had formed the group with 50 students and were eventually joined by many refugees from camps in Pakistan. In 1995, the Taliban also captured the province of Herat and eventually Kabul. By 1998, almost the entire country was under the control of Taliban. From 1996 to 2001, the Taliban held power over roughly 3/4 of Afghanistan. The initial reaction of the Afghan public to the Taliban taking over was mostly positive. This is because they seem to offer stability to a country wrecked by long and bloody civil wars. Afghans were tired of fighting between Soviets and the Mujahideen, and the Taliban's promise to restore peace and prosperity, as well as to enforce the Sharia law in the country, were popular amongst the masses. The Taliban endorsed their interpretation of the Islamic Sharia law mixed with the Pashtun tribal code, which led to human rights violations of ordinary Afghans under brutal oppression. Public executions were held for those accused of murder and adultery, and there was a complete disregard for women and their rights. Because of this, they were criticized by most countries, and only 3 countries recognized the Taliban: Pakistan, UAE, and Saudi Arabia. The 9/11 attacks in the US drew renewed focus on Afghanistan, as it was accused of sheltering Osama bin Laden and the Al-Qaeda, who were blamed for the attacks. As a result, the US intervened in Afghanistan to deny a safe haven to the Al-Qaeda to operate from. Pakistan also officially broke up diplomatic ties with them. However, many top leaders of the Taliban are said to have escaped to Pakistan, from where they were controlling the organization. The Taliban were removed from power in October 2001 by a coalition of forces led by the USA. A new government was set up, which led to a lot of improvement in the international relations and development. By 2006, the Taliban had regrouped and were able to mobilize fighters in its battle against foreign occupiers and their allies. In the next decade, the US Army stayed in Afghanistan to help the Afghan government and suppress the Taliban. But the Taliban kept reappearing from various places. Finally, in 2018, the Trump administration began formal face-to-face talks with the group without involving the Afghan government. In February 2020, the US and the Taliban signed an agreement that paved the way for a full withdrawal of foreign soldiers and a step towards ending the war. Along with this, a separate joint declaration was also signed between the Afghan government and the US. The peace deal is expected to kick off two processes: a phased withdrawal of US troops, one which is already in progress, and a dialogue between the Afghan government and the Taliban. The deal is a fundamental step to deliver a permanent ceasefire and the future political roadmap for Afghanistan and the Central Asian regions. Some of the salient features of the deal are withdrawal of US troops from the country, commitment by Taliban to not allow any terrorist activities in Afghanistan, removal of US sanctions on Taliban leaders, and release of prisoners. As the US prepares to complete its withdrawal by 31st August after two decades of war, the Taliban are yet again overrunning Afghan military outposts, towns, and villages, and surrounding major cities, fueling fears that they could once again topple the government. In recent weeks, the Taliban have gained several strategic districts, particularly along the borders with Iran, Uzbekistan, and Tajikistan. The Taliban's claim that they control 85% of the districts is widely seen as exaggerated. The claim is impossible to independently verify and remains disputed by the government. US intelligence analysts and senior military officials say that Afghan government could fall between 6 and 12 months after the departure of the American forces. According to the experts, there can be three possible scenarios. First, Taliban taking over the country. Second, a political settlement in which the Taliban and the government agree to some power-sharing mechanism, which is highly unlikely. And an all-out civil war between the government, backed by the West, and the Taliban. The failure to attain a political settlement may cause Pakistan to fall back to smoothing its ties with the Taliban, which has challenging implications for India's security interests. Afghanistan is also important for India's energy security. The proposed Trans-Afghanistan pipeline will bring in oil from Turkmenistan to India, and this requires stable Afghan government in place. India has also committed huge economic assistance for developmental purposes and has invested in large number of projects to jumpstart developmental activities in Afghanistan. For Pakistan, it shares a 2,600-kilometer border with Afghanistan and has been a safe haven for multiple militant outfits, including the Afghan Taliban, owing to its regional security interests with India. If the Pakistan intelligence-linked Taliban comes to power, Pakistan will have a strategic input to calm its shared border. It will allow Islamabad to focus its efforts on destabilizing Kashmir and will deprive India of a potential ally. However, a Taliban takeover of Afghanistan could also strengthen separatist movement in Pashtun-majority areas along the Pakistan-Afghanistan border, driven by Pashtun nationalism, the same as the Taliban. Afghanistan plays an important role in the success of China's Belt and Road Initiative. As Beijing plans to expand trade links across Eurasia and Africa, it becomes crucial to develop economic ties with Afghanistan, just like it had done with Pakistan with the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. China is developing ties with both the Afghanistan government and seeking better relations with the Taliban, having organized meetings with their leaders. Beijing's repressive treatment of China's minority Uyghur Muslims has been a source of tension with the Taliban, which has enjoyed closer ties with the Uyghurs. China's mounting influence in Afghan affairs is reflected in recent statements made by the Taliban leaders that seek to distance themselves from the Uyghurs' plight. Only time will tell what the future holds for Afghanistan and its people. I really hope that this video was able to give you a deep understanding of the current issue. Please make sure you like and share this video. And again, don't forget to subscribe to our channel with the notification bell on so that you can stay updated.